Chief complaints, 31-year-old gentleman working at a call center was admitted on 16-9-2020 with a history of weakness of both upper and lower limbs and change of voice since one day.
One second. I'll just bring my paper.
Can you hear me? Can you see me?
Okay, please go ahead. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So, 31-year-old gentleman working at a colleague's call center was admitted on 16-9-20 with a history of weakness of both upper and lower limbs with and change of voice since one day.
Right.
History of presenting illness. The patient was apparently normal on 15-9-20. On 16-9-20, he had his dinner at 4 a.m. and slept. 9:30 a.m., the patient woke up, noticed he was unable to get out of his bed, though he can move his legs in bed. At the same time, he was able to move from side to side in his bed. He was able to sit with support with his left hand. 10:30 a.m., he noticed that the right upper limb is weak from shoulder to hand at the same time. He was able to move his both arms above the head.
One minute.
11.
Go back. Now, 4 a.m. he slept and with 5.5 hours later, he was unable to get out of the bed, though he can move his legs in bed.
Yes, sir.
What does that mean?
He was not able to get out of his bed. But he can move his leg in the bed itself. He can't get up from the bed and stand.
So that means he can move his legs in bed means there is motor power, but not enough motor power in trunk muscles as well as in the leg muscles. So there is a weakness, but not total paralysis. Now, other one you said he was able to sit with support with his left hand.
Yes, sir.
That means there is enough power in the left hand for him to take support and sit up.
Yes,
so the left hand, left upper limb, he still has got some power with which he is able to turn to the left and take support and sit up. Okay. Then at that time he did not know about his right upper limb. But in another 1 hour, he noticed that right upper limb is also weak. Isn't it? So that means within 1 hour from the time 9:30 a.m. to 10:30 a.m., he had weakness of all four limbs, but we do not know the onset of the weakness. It's very important because 4 a.m. he slept, 9:30 he woke up. So this weakness might have started at 4:30 a.m., 5 a.m. or 6 a.m. or 9 a.m., we do not know. So the real onset of the illness, we do not know. But after the onset, after awakening, he was able to find that his left limb is better than right limb. Because of that, he could sit up. Now, the important point for the onset of the neurological illness is extremely important in patients with stroke, stroke. Because we have a time frame before we think of a thrombolysis treatment. You understand? So the onset of illness. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
For everybody, am I audible, please?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So onset of illness is extremely important when there is a neurological story, especially so in patient with stroke, because within 3 hours, thrombolysis should be done. In some cases, up to 6 hours. So when a person sleeps in the night and gets up in the morning with a dense left hemiplegia, we called it as a stroke, awake stroke. So we do not know when it has happened. So similarly here, just to inform you that the onset of illness, we are not aware. And he has started noticing one after the other, the motor weakness. Okay, next slide.
So at 11:30 a.m., he had a glass of juice with his left hand. He tried getting up from his bed, but was not able to do. 12:30 p.m., his left upper limb was also weak. He was not able to move his both upper limbs by this time. He developed difficulty in holding a glass of water and buttoning his shirt at this time. And by 1 p.m., he had his lunch, which was fed by his relatives. Then he was carried to the hospital by relatives.
Okay. Now, at 11:30, he was able to hold a glass of juice with his left hand and drink. Okay. That means his left upper limb is still having some motor power, though weak, but able to do independent activity. Now he has tried to get up from his bed, but was not able to, because the left upper limb was not having enough power to support his body to come to the sitting position from supine position. So that's an important thing to analyze each symptom. He had enough strength to take the glass of juice, but not enough strength to support his body to sit up from supine position. Now, 12:30, he also had weakness. Then he had all other glass of water, combing, buttoning. Now, what does this mean? Difficulty to comb, button his shirt means what?
Distal weakness also.
So, he had weakness of the distal muscles of the upper limb. And at 1 p.m., he had his lunch fed by his relatives. What does this tell us?
Because he can't do any activities with his limbs by this time.
The upper limb is, the motor weakness of the upper limb did not allow him to feed for himself. But the important point is, he had no difficulty in swallowing.
Yes, sir. He has no difficulty.
He had no difficulty in swallowing, and there was no nasal regurgitation at that point of time. Now, let us stop here. Now, you are saying that he was carried to the hospital by relatives. Now, up till now is the history.
Yes, sir.
Now, you know, in neurology or in medicine, the diagnosis is thought of at the end of history, even before you start examining the patient. So, what do you think at this stage? The patient has what?
Sir, progressive.
Not asking diagnosis. I'm asking you, what is it he has got? In simple terms, he has a quadriparesis. You understand?
Yes.
So.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
He has weakness of both lower limbs and weakness of both upper limbs. Then you have to go up lower limbs, lowest, and then comes the upper limbs, and then comes the cranial nerves. The lowest cranial nerve is 9, 10, 11, 12 in the medulla. So at this point, there is no symptom suggestive of lower cranial nerve involvement. If the disease is progressing upwards, so we need to see that.
Yeah.
So the patient has quadriparesis, right? The moment you, at the end of the history, say, okay, I'm now dealing with a patient who has got quadriparesis. So immediately the thought comes whether it is a spinal cord disease or whether it is a peripheral nervous system, that means radiculopathy, or still further neuromuscular junction or muscle disease. So these are the four things which one should think of.
Yes.
Is it a quadriplegia, let us say transverse myelitis of the cervical cord? Is it quadriplegia due to root involvement, like radiculopathy, or is it a neuromuscular junction like myasthenia, or is it a muscle disease like myopathy or myositis? So I'm just telling you how one should start analyzing at this end of the story. Now, with this background, one should start examining the patient, because now I have already thought, is it spinal cord, is it root, is it a neuromuscular junction, or is it a muscle? Okay, what is the characteristic of neuromuscular junction disease? What is the characteristic of neuromuscular junction disease? Anybody can type it also, chat.
Sir.
Pardon?
Waxing.
Yeah. So waxing and waning or fatigability. But in this patient, at this point of time, the history being so short, we cannot think of waxing and waning. Suppose the patient has a within a 1 day morning, he was very weak, and afternoon he was okay enough to walk and button his shirt, and again by evening he became bad, then we can think of that. But the history being so short, we are not able to get this waxing and waning, or what is called as the correct word to use is fatigability. The disease doesn't wax and wane. It is the fatigability. That means with a motor action, he becomes weak. If he's just lying down, there is no waxing and waning. So please use the word fatigability whenever you think of a neuromuscular or myasthenia. So that is how we should, at the end of the story itself, we should focus on one of these four. Now let us see next slide. Examination. Go to the next.
No history of any sensory disturbance. Yes, sir.
What do you mean by no history?
No history of any sensory.
Did you ask? What did you ask in the history? To say.
I asked whether he is able to. He is able to feel cold or hot or cold sensation, having his juice of water. Whether he is able to get the pain sensation. When I examined.
When you're talking of sensory disturbances, you should talk about positive sensory disturbance and negative ones. Positive sensory disturbances.
Any tingling.
Tingling, paresthesia.
Any tingling, any numbness or paresthesia.
Correct.
No, nothing was there, sir, in the history.
Okay. Then how did you ask
for? And there is no cranial nerve.
No, wait. How did you ask for
cranial nerve sensory? Negative loss of sensation.
No. You should ask practical questions. Is he able to feel the cloth which he's wearing? Okay. Has he rubbed his, somebody
okay,
is rubbing the legs and all that. Usually whenever there is a paralysis, the relatives will come and rub the hand, palm and all that. So was he able to feel the sensation?
Uh-huh.
Understand? To say okay, hot sir. And cold, I'm sure he has not gone for
yes,
to have hot water, cold water. So you must be very practical in your questions.
No.
Okay. Now, cranial nerve dysfunction.
Yeah.
You should ask for specifically.
Was there any.
Where cranial nerves?
Facial nerve. Yes.
Okay.
Any difficulty in swallowing food? Any changes in the facial muscles, any, is there any deviation of mouth, or is there any fluid getting out of the one side of angle of mouth?
You said in the history he has got some change in voice or no? You said that change of voice.
Yes, sir. Change in voice was.
Then yeah, you say cranial nerves.
Hoarseness, like hoarse kind of.
Huh? Hello?
Yeah, sir.
You said
hoarseness was there, sir.
Now then how do you say
hoarse voice?
That is due to what? Which cranial nerve is
concerned
with the hoarseness? Huh?
Sabek.
No, once you say in the history there is a hoarseness in the voice, that means the vocal cords must be affected, isn't it? If the story is correct, you cannot say no history of cranial nerve dysfunction.
Yes.
You will have to say that the patient has cranial nerve dysfunction because of the hoarseness of voice, the laryngeal dysfunction, either directly due to laryngitis or due to the water supply to the vocal cords, that is the vagus nerve, as somebody has already put it in the chat. Good. So don't say no history of cranial nerve dysfunction because you have already said in the history, in the initial stage. Okay, then.
So no bowel and bladder disturbances was.
No, instead of
and no history of any trauma.
Wait. Now he got up at 9 o'clock, and he was brought to the hospital in the afternoon. You must tell us in this time whether he had passed urine or not. If he has not passed urine, was he aware of the bladder discomfort? Because this no history of bowel bladder disturbance is good when the story is 4 days, 1 week like that. Here we are talking about an illness of a few hours. So when he woke up from bed, did he go to the washroom? Was he able to pass urine in the bed?
No.
Or was he having discomfort in the suprapubic area that he wants to pass but it was not coming? You must tell about this story.
Yes, sir. I mean, he didn't go to the bathroom, sir.
These are the questions you should ask when you see this patient in the casualty.
Okay.
Tell me.
Yes, I have asked him. He didn't go to the bathroom, sir, that day.
Obviously, no. But what about the bladder evacuation in the bed?
No, sir. Nothing was there, but only after catheterization.
So did he have sensation of bladder fullness?
No. He was not having any. No. And he was not. He has control over bowel and bladders.
No. Was he feeling a sensation of bladder fullness that he wants to pass urine?
No, sir. No.
It was not there.
No. He was not having any.
Okay.
No.
Suppose the patient did not have the sensation of bladder fullness, it may mean two things. One, the bladder is not full enough. Okay. After all, he slept at 4 a.m.
Yes, sir.
And then he is brought by 1 o'clock. Or alternatively, bladder is full, but he still doesn't have the sensation of fullness. Now, how do we distinguish this? When you examine the patient, the bladder is palpable right up to the umbilicus, let us say. Bladder is really full, but he doesn't have a sensation of fullness. That shows that he has got loss of bladder sensation. You understand? But on examination, if you don't feel the very full bladder, then it may be that the urine itself is not sufficient to cause the fullness. Okay, now next is for past history.
There is no known comorbidities, diabetes, hypertension, bronchiasma, seizure disorder, or pulmonary tuberculosis. No history. There was an history of fever and loose motion for 7 days, 2 weeks earlier, which was diagnosed as typhoid.
Okay, now do you think that history of fever and loose motion is important in this patient as you are taking the history?
Yes, sir.
It is, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Now, if it has to be linked, it has to be linked to what we thought at the end of the story, that it may be spinal cord, roots, neuromuscular junction, or muscle disease. If all these four are thought of, the fever and loose motions, if it is connected to the present problem, then what it excludes is a neuromuscular disease, because myasthenia doesn't have any such premorbid condition. And even the muscle disease can be ? But certainly it is most likely it is involvement of the root or spinal cord, because post-infectious myelitis or radiculitis is possible. So this has got some significance, fever and loose motions. Okay, next.
Yes. So coming to general examination, the patient was conscious, coherent, cooperative, and in supine position, oriented to time, place, and person. There was no pallor, ectrosinusitis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, and edema. Vitals, PP 130-90, heart rate 86, respiratory rate 18, febrile, and JVP was not rated.
Okay, nothing very significant. Okay, next.
So coming to neurological examination, his higher ventral function was normal. Cranial nerves are 10th, apart from 10th, other cranial nerves are normal. Then speech is also normal. come to motor examination. Patient is in supine position, upper limb and lower limb in extended position. There was nutrition wise, there was no muscle wasting.
Right. Suppose you have seen wasting of muscles. One second. Suppose you have seen wasting of muscles. What is the reaction?
So it's chronic. For chronic disorder, maybe.
Yeah, but the story is acute, isn't it? The story is in acute and muscle wasting cannot come in less than 24 hours or so. So that means the muscle wasting has to be explained on some other pre-existing disease.
Yes, sir.
Understand?
Yeah.
So it is important that each point is analyzed properly. You don't expect muscle wasting, so it is not there. But suppose the patient has got, let us say, motor neuron disease or even CIDP, where the patient may be having some wasting, then there may be an acute exacerbation of the pre-existing disease. So the present sudden weakness may be an exacerbation of pre-existing disease. You will have to go back and ask him, did you have motor weakness earlier? Did you notice the wasting? So all those questions need to be asked.
Yes.
Next.
Yes. So nutrition, upper limb and lower limb, bulk, right and arm, right.
Okay, you said there's no wasting, so we'll not go into the measurements.
Yes. Okay. So then coming to tone, the muscles are they both bilateral upper limb and lower limb. There is hypotonia proximally and distally. Both muscles having hypotonia.
So, what are the conditions where you get hypotonia?
Lower motor neuron.
Yes.
Myopathies.
Lower motor neuron. And
involvement.
Even in muscular disease in the later stage also, you can get hypotonia. But can you get hypotonia in upper motor neuron? That's very important.
No, sir. So you only during the initial phase, only during the initial attack, maybe hypotonia.
Only during?
But, usually hypotonia. Initial attack at acute phase.
Right, very good. So in acute paraplegia and acute quadriplegia, one can get hypotonia in upper motor neuron lesion. Okay.
Yes.
So when you're examining this patient, when you have found hypotonia, that means it can be still upper motor neuron or a lower motor neuron. Okay. Next.
Yes, so coming to power of muscles, shoulder, both bilaterally 1/5, elbow flexor and extensor, flexor 1 to 2/5 on right and 2/5 on left. So extensor right 2/5 and left 2/5. So elbow aspect, left side is little more power is there. Then coming to wrist, flexor aspect 1/5 on right side and left side it's 2/5, and extensor 1/5 on right and 2/5 on left. So comparatively, left side has more power when I examined.
So it's an asymmetric weakness.
Yeah.
The weakness is more on asymmetric. The right side. And also more on the proximal, relatively proximal compared to the distal, or almost equal. Okay, next.
Yes, sir. Almost equal.
We have another 2 minutes.
And then coming to...
1 second.
Yeah, coming to the lower...
All the participants, we have another 2-3 minutes. Whenever it gets stopped, we'll stop. And please come back after 10 minutes for the continuation. Okay. Now, lower limb, you just summarize what you want to find.
Lower limb also, actually, when I examined, the power was more on the lower limb. It was 3/5 on the hip aspect, but coming to the knee, it was a 2/5, and ankle flexors, plantar flexion was 2/5, and dorsiflexion was 2/5 on bilaterally. They're equal, but comparatively, they have more power when I examined.
So,
and toe grip was moderately weak. He was able to move his lower limbs when I saw the patient, but upper limb, he was not able to move at all.
Okay, so lower limb is slightly better power, but according to you, the proximal muscles are better than the distal muscles, because you said ankle
in the lower
five, leg. Whereas hip is 3/5.
Yeah,
so 2/5. Slightly.
Yeah.
Distal muscles are more weaker in the lower limbs as compared to the upper limbs, where proximal muscles are more weak. Okay, next.
Yes, sir. Coordination was not elicited because the patient was not able to move. There was no abnormal movements. And coming to the reflexes, superficial reflexes, I have done plantar and abnormal reflex, it was absent. And all deep tendon reflexes were absent. And coming to the sensory system, pain, touch, and temperature.
Reflexes absent means, what does it tell us? Is it upper motor neuron or?
Bilateral. Sir, in upper motor neuron, it will be hyper reflex more.
Mm-hmm.
But in lower motor neuron, it will be areflexic. So it will be lower motor neuron.
Can it not be upper motor neuron in this patient? You said when the motor system examination, hypotonia. You said hypotonia.
Only during the initial phase.
In acute UMN lesion.
Only during the initial. Yes, sir. Will present as hyporeflexia.
So in this patient, it can still be an upper motor neuron lesion. The reflexes are absent, sir, because it is an acute illness.
Yeah.
Are you understanding? Sir. I'm just trying to impress upon all of you that in acute paraplegia, acute quadriplegia, the tone will be reduced. The reflexes will be absent. It does not mean it is a lower motor neuron lesion. It can still be a UMN lesion, an acute one. Okay, then.
Hmm. Yes. Then coming to sensory system, pain, touch, and temperature was normal, and gait not able to elicit because patient was not able to stand.
Not able to elicit. Patient cannot get up anyway. Okay, next.
Yes. So coming to the diagnosis, sir. So neurodeficit, it was a pure LMN quadriparesis, lower motor neuron quadriparesis. It was asymmetrical because it's proximal greater than distal, involving in the upper limb C5 to T1 bilateral and lower limb L1 to S5 nerve roots bilateral. And coming to the anatomical diagnosis, it is a motor radical involvement. And pathological diagnosis is due to demyelination. Etiology may be post-infective.
Good. So you have followed the steps. I think all of you must remember the analysis of a neurology case. Step one is the most important. When you say neurodeficit, it is don't repeat the same thing. Patient has got a hypotonia, areflexia, and all that. What is the conclusion of the examination? The conclusion of the examination, as you have rightly said, is a pure lower motor neuron quadriparesis. The word pure is very, very important to differentiate a spinal cord acute UMN quadriparesis from a peripheral lesion like a radiculopathy. So pure LMN quadriparesis is the neurodeficit. Then you have to qualify that asymmetrical, as you have said, proximal more than distal. And where is the anatomical localization? That C5, T1, L1, S5 should come in the anatomical localization. The anatomical localization is the motor roots. Which motor roots? That is the anatomical diagnosis. All the cervical roots and as well as the lumbosacral roots. So that is the step two, is the anatomical diagnosis. Please remember, in the step one, when you say neurodeficit, please go back and ask yourself why the patient has come to me. Does this explain the patient's problem? What you have not explained is hoarseness of voice. You want to say hoarseness of voice is due to some infection, laryngitis, or you want to say it is a neurological deficit?
Mm.
If suppose the vagus nerve is affected, did you check for the jag reflex, palatal movement?
Only just check the uvula is in center or not, and also the tongue, whether it is deviated to one side or not. DDs. Sir, coming to differential diagnosis. Sir, shall I start?
Yeah, you said, tell me.
Sir, coming to differential diagnosis, acute inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy, then paralytic poliomyelitis, porphyria polyneuropathy, botulism, metabolic maybe hypo or hyperkalemia, or vascular malformations of the coat.
Yeah, that's good. So I am very happy that you have talked about hypokalemia or hyperkalemia, because oftentimes in clinical practice, we find patients are investigated right, left and center. And by the time the evening, all the investigations are over, by our next day morning, they are completely normal. So it is not because patient has received IVIG or anything like that. It is simply because of the hypokalemia. So every patient who comes with an acute onset of pure motor quadriplegia, please do an ECG. It is the most important thing. And I would also like to stress, people who have come with acute onset of hemiplegia, especially right hemiplegia with aphasia, the first investigation you must do is an ECG, which of course is done routinely in all five-star hospitals. But remember, because a patient may have myocardial infarction, hypotension, leading to hemiplegia. So what requires immediate treatment is myocardial infarction, not the hemiplegia alone. So please be aware of this thing, that ECG is a must in an acute pure motor quadriplegia like this to diagnose hypokalemia or hyperkalemia. It may be rare, and it is rare, but it is an eminently treatable condition with very little investigations. And don't forget to do an ECG in a patient who has come for hemiplegia, especially when he has aphasia, he cannot tell you he had a chest pain, or it may be a silent MI also. Okay, next. Is it over?
Investigation, sir. What nerve condition study.
Yeah.
So nerve condition study and electromyography to know the anatomical diagnosis, anatomical confirmation of the diagnosis. Then for etiology, we can do a CSF analysis for any infections. Then CPK, ESR, serum electrolytes, rule out any metabolic problems. Then vitamin B12 and thyroid panel for, that is for chronic actually. And serology, antibodies against campylobacter jejuni, microbial pneumonia, EBV, HSV, infections, ruling out for inflammatory. And muscle biopsy to rule out the myopathies, and MR angiography to rule out any malformations in the spinal cord.
Why do you want to do muscle biopsy in this patient?
Not this patient.
The patient has come to you with 12-hour story, and yes, muscle biopsy is an invasive procedure. It is not required at all.
Okay.
Understand. So, whenever we finish diagnosis, the investigations are of two types. One is investigation to confirm the anatomical localization. And very correctly, you said the anatomical localization being a radiculopathy. So nerve conduction study is the investigation of choice to confirm. Somebody's noise is there. To confirm the anatomical localization. Okay. Now, nerve conduction study is part of electroneuromyography. Nerve conduction is more important than the EMG. Okay.
Yes.
So, in acute onset like this, we just do only nerve conduction. There's no need for electromyography. In the sense, electromyography requires a needle to be put into the muscle. And that is more expensive because the needle has to be thrown off. It cannot be reused because of the chances of reinfection. So we don't see anything in the EMG. And to remind all of you, the nerve conduction will be abnormal in the later part of the illness. So within the first 1 week, the nerve conduction may be normal. The lumbar puncture and CSF analysis it shows the albuminocytological dissociation. Again, this is only in the second week of the disease. So when you have seen the patient in the first week or first 24 hours, like in this patient, it is purely a clinical diagnosis. Muscle biopsy is certainly not required. MR angiography, why do you want MR angiography of what? Brain.
Sir, spine, sir.
You must mention spine angiography. Now, do you think, see, when you say MR spine angiography, you are talking of spinal cord disease. You understand?
Yes, sir. That's why rule out.
What rule out? In the clinical diagnosis, you have said it is a pure motor system involvement.
Yes, sir.
If a spinal cord has got involvement, you will find a combination of sensory motor. Anyway, that I am going to stress now. So that is why, please remember, don't blindly start investigating a patient. Don't. Always ask whether this investigation is going to confirm the diagnosis or is it just written routinely without any purpose, because it is not only invasive, it is very expensive. So MR spinal angiography is done only when we think of patient having a spinal cord disease. And before you do angiography, you do MR spine first, isn't it? Okay.
Yes, sir.